we are very excited to have Christian Picciolini here tonight presenting his book, White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement and How I Got Out. And we'll also be having a discussion led by Professor Fred Gardefee as part of tonight's event, and of course, time for Q&A at the end. I'd now like to introduce the Dean of the Institute, Anthony Tamburi.
Welcome, everybody. Buonasera. We had a wonderful conversation yesterday, Christian and I, and that will air October 9. I just want to recommend that you buy this book. It's a powerful read. It is a redemption story. It's his redemption story, but I think it's also a universal redemption story, especially in these times today of what's going on in the United States. Elsewhere too, but we're in the United States.
After leaving the white supremacist skinhead movement he helped build in America during the 1980s and 90s, Christian Picciolini earned a degree in international relations from DePaul University. He launched Gold Mill Group, a global digital media and counter-extremism consulting firm. In 2016, he won an Emmy Award for his role in producing an anti-hate advertising campaign aimed at helping people disengage from extremist groups. His life since leaving the white supremacist movement over two decades ago has been dedicated to helping others counter racism and violent extremism by co-founding the organization Life After Hate. Christian now leads the Free Radicals Project, the world's first global extremism disengagement platform. Christian has spoken on the TEDx stage and to audiences all over the world, sharing his unique and extensive knowledge, teaching all who are willing to learn about building greater peace and acceptance through empathy and compassion. He has helped over 100 people disengage from hate groups. Christian's involvement in the early American skinhead movement is chronicled in his memoir, White American Youth, My Descent into America's Most Violent Hate Movement and How I Got Out, for sale here tonight. In 2018, Christian premiered Breaking Hate on MSNBC, a television docuseries produced by Part 2 Pictures. Please welcome Christian Picciolini.
Buonasera. I just want to say how grateful I am to be here. Thank you for having me. But I wouldn't be telling you the whole story if I didn't say that there were also people who went through similar experiences as I did. Who might have darker skin than me, who don't get the second chance like I did. And I think it's important that we recognize that because I might not be here if that weren't true. I want to make sure and use my voice to speak for everybody I can. I just got a chance to spend 2 hours with one of my favorite Italian-Americans. You might know him. His name is Alphonse D'Abruzzo. Anybody? No? You may know him by his other name, Alan Alda for MASH. If you take the AL from Alphonse and the DA from D'Abruzzo, that's how they got Alda. I just found that out. My story, I'm going to read about my story, but I just want to say something before I do that. In my experience, having left 23 years ago from that movement and working with people, and the number's actually 200 people that I've helped, so you have an old bio. You know, people don't go into these movements, and I've seen this time and time again, necessarily because of ideology. They do it because they're broken, and they're looking for acceptance, and they're looking for things that are more important than the fact that they have to hurt people to do that. And if we want to stop extremism from happening, then we need to make sure that when our children are born or our grandchildren, that we teach them from the first day how to respect people and respect themselves. So that's it. I'm actually going to, so the book was published twice. The first time was self-published. I did it myself. It was called Romantic Violence. And then a publisher came along, and they wanted to put it out, so they made me take out some of my favorite parts and update it. I had to do that to update it. But I'm going to read you some of my favorite parts because that's my Italian-American story for the most part. So this is from the introduction. I am not my father, nor my mother, not my grandparents. I am neither my brother nor my friends. My life is my own. The actions and decisions of my youth and early adulthood were not determined by anyone who came before me. I am my own invention, shaped both by my imagination and ambition. And it wasn't until my two sons were born that I began to understand my responsibilities in connection to others. But I'm getting ahead of myself, and you deserve an explanation. A glimpse into the lives of those people I claim not to be. A claim that does not imply any lack of love on anyone's part. One thing that distinguishes me from my immediate family is that I am the firstborn in the United States. When my mother tells the story of my birth, her warm Mediterranean eyes light up and her voice, normally steady and sure, quickens. She laces the story with Italian phrases when she recounts it to someone in Blue Island, the working class neighborhood on the south side of Chicago that her Italian family immigrated to when she was 16. When she chronicles the tale of my birth to my family and friends, she peppers her story with frequent references to the notion that everybody, Italians and Americans alike, loved me. If I could recall my entry into the world and tell the story myself, I suspect it would be a bit different than hers. While she was pushing and straining for nearly 24 hours to get me out, I was impatiently wriggling my way down the birth canal, ready to take charge, or so I imagine, in a rush to see what was ahead of me. I may have been annoyed that I hadn't been given ample warning, but as I felt the first blast of air fill my lungs, I would have already been calculating the best way to handle the situation. To the attending doctor, I was yet another little miracle, a slippery, mucus-covered newborn, like all the rest of his deliveries. He was so intent on making sure I took my first breath and verifying that all parts were there that he missed the clear signs I had been born alert, brave, and ready to take on a new reality into which I had arrived. Blinking rapidly, my eyes impatient to adjust to the cruel bright lights, I was eager to take in everything that was going on. Had I been able to talk, I would have asked the nurse to step back, pleaded with my mother to calm down, and warned the doctor to think twice before slapping me again. I would have objected to their tests and insisted that I didn't want to be compared, labeled, charted, or measured in any way. I was swaddled in a soft, warm blanket, the unmistakably warm love my mother bestowed on me when the nurse put her in my arms, set me up for life with the patent knowledge that love and attention were clearly worth pursuing. I came equipped with a desire to live life fully, to explore the unknown, and to have my existence count for something. For many years, I thought this meant being an instrumental member of a group undertaking a significant mission. Considering how vitally having a place in the world defined my actions throughout my childhood, youth, and early adulthood, I have to believe that I came hardwired with those desires. From as early as I can recall, I wanted to be the game-winning athlete who was carried off the field on my team's shoulders after hitting an upper deck grand slam to win the championship series in the bottom of the ninth inning, to be the hero who tackled the gun-toting hijacker, to have a national holiday named after me for my contributions to the human race. I didn't always care how I achieved greatness, but that hunger for glory was what made me tick. I went to great lengths to try to fulfill that dream, and some of the actions I took still fill me with dread and regret. For more than two decades, I have searched my soul, wondering how I could have strayed so far off track, committed such vile acts of hatred, and advocated for the annihilation of people based solely on the color of their skin, who they loved, or the God to whom they prayed. In trying to reconcile my actions, I have come to believe that at the root of my motivations lies a basic human necessity. Far stronger than my overwhelming desire to achieve prominence was the profound, essential human need to belong. A force I could not have articulated at the time, but one which propelled me into actions both good and bad, harmless and treacherous, self-fulfilling and self-destructive. This need, coupled with my tendency toward ambition, defined my actions that led me down a troubled and dark path to prejudice, racism, and violence. What follows is my story. Though I wish I could rewrite a significant part of my life, I have been honest. I have not sugarcoated my past, even though the bitterness of my convictions during my troubled years was brutal and immense. My reservations about my hateful actions were also true at the time, and I haven't changed them to fit a retrospective view. If anything, I hope the reader despises my duplicity as much as he or she abhors my deeds. It is worse to have acted as I did when I knew better, and I include my doubts to emphasize, not relieve, my guilt. My hope in writing this book is that others will read it and heed how disturbingly easy it is for someone without prior inclination towards prejudice or violence to enter a world laden with unadulterated hate, that others may see the desire to belong, if taken to the extreme and not addressed early enough, can have repugnant results, and that the promise of power is sometimes so seductive, an impressionable mind can be persuaded to commit atrocious acts in its pursuit. I write this book with optimism that others will search for identity, belonging, and acceptance in healthy, inclusive communities, and will have the strength to walk away from empty promises, and that people will listen to those who encourage them to be compassionate human beings instead of finding a place among those who prey on the insecure and exploit their loneliness, fear, confusion, and feelings of worthlessness. I hope that by exposing racism, hate will have fewer places to hide. As we did every Christmas, my parents and I went to Blue Island to celebrate with family and to await Santa Claus, or Babbo Natale, although I stopped believing in him the moment I noticed him wearing my dad's gold pinky ring and Italian loafers. My mother and father didn't quite understand the whole American Santa came down the chimney routine, but they did know American kids got presents from him. So they made sure we had a decorated tree and that there were plenty of gifts for their wonderful son who everybody adored. We opened presents on Christmas Eve after eating a traditional Italian holiday dinner, loads of pasta, of course, and various seafood dishes, including a salted codfish called baccalà. Wine that had fermented in the basement and was stored in any glass bottle my grandmother had saved. Recycled wine jugs, old glass pop bottles, spent whiskey handles, flowed like water from a hose. After dinner, we'd all head into the family room, sit on the plastic-covered sofas, and open gifts. On this particular Christmas Eve, the adults talked for far too long, wine and espresso making them more chatty than usual, which in an Italian family, where tongues are never still, and opinions rarely held back, was really saying something. I vividly recall thinking dinner would literally never end, but finally my mother leaned close and said in her teasing tone, "What do you have to say for yourself, Christian?" I stared glumly at my plate. Would all the talking never end? My mother tousled my hair, becoming aware, as all the adults suddenly were, that I had only one thing in my mind, opening presents. "Shall we see if Santa Claus brought you something this year?" she asked. "Have you been a good boy? I bet Santa brought you something very, very special." The suspense was far too great for good behavior. I pushed my chair back and jumped down to the floor, shouting greedily, "I want to see." Their laughter and the sound of chairs scraping against the ceramic tiles filled the stuffy kitchen as I dashed to the archway that led into the living room. They were hot on my heels, and as I crossed the threshold, I snapped on the lights, and there it was, a beautiful shiny red bicycle with the biggest bow I'd ever seen. Ignoring all the other gifts, I sprinted to it and yanked off the bow. There had to be a Santa Claus after all. My parents would never have thought to buy me anything so perfect, so cool, so amazing. I hugged it, kissed it, and jumped onto the seat, my feet reaching for the pedals. "No, Christian, no," my grandmother cried. "Not in the house. Bicycles are not for inside. You'll ruin the carpet. You'll scratch the tiles." I jumped back off the bike and, holding the handlebars tightly in both hands, plowed through the stacks of gifts to the back door. "Stop," Nonna called after me. "It's freezing out there. It's too dark. You'll fall and hurt yourself, or you'll catch a cold and die," she crossed herself and added, "God forgive me." Ignoring her pleas, I wrenched open the door and made my escape. I darted down the steps, holding tight onto my new prized possession, and at the foot of the stairs, I scrambled onto the seat and wobbled down the sidewalk that ran along the house. Strings of sparkling Christmas lights on bushes and fences lit my path like a runway as I made my debut on the coolest bike on the planet. If it was cold, I didn't notice. If Nonna and my parents called out warnings or prayed to God for my safety, I didn't hear. Only one thing mattered: freedom. I was no longer a helpless little boy in the perpetual care of old people, a child transported from one place to another without a word to say about it. Oh no, I was all grown up. I had my own wheels. I had come to life. And I could join the other kids in the neighborhood now, ride with them, tearing down alleys, up side streets, on my way to visit even more friends. But first, I had to make some. By the time I was in sixth grade, I could no longer bear the stigma of being an outcast at St. Damien. I loathed it so much I actually stooped to praying every day around lunchtime. The other kids bought hot meals from the school lunch lady or had colorful tin lunch boxes full of homemade cookies and ham and cheese sandwiches prepared by their moms. My mother was often rushed to get to work in the morning, so she'd show up during lunch period with something she'd sped to buy through a fast food window between doing a hairstyle and rolling a perm. Shortly before the bell rang for lunch every day, I'd close my eyes and pray, turning to the false hope the nuns gave us that God watched out for us if we humbled ourselves to ask for help. Dear God, if you're really out there, just this once, please pay attention. I know there are probably a whole lot of other sinners down here, but I'd appreciate it if you'd ignore all of them but me this afternoon. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and you can take the rest of the day off. I'm not asking for anything huge like a new Sony Walkman or peace or that another gust of wind will fly under Miss McGowan's dress and blow it way up to her neck again. I only want one simple thing. I paused for a minute to give the big guy a chance to realize how little I was asking for. Please, God, I beg you, don't let my mother show up with another McDonald's Happy Meal at lunchtime today. But these words apparently never had enough time to travel from my mouth to his ears, because every day, like clockwork, when the bell rang and my class streamed into the lunchroom to eat, there my mom would be, stationed at the door, hurrying toward me, her long leather jacket looking stylish to nobody but herself, and her blonde hair sticking out at odd angles because she'd rushed out of the beauty shop in the middle of a self-dye job. Her high-heeled boots would hit the polished linoleum floor with sharp staccato notes, tapping out impending doom. This particular day was no different. Jake Riley tripped me as we lined up for the cafeteria. "What's for lunch, lick my weenie?" he sneered. "Your mom bringing you another little baby Happy Meal today?" When the bell rang, I prayed she wouldn't be in the hall, but there she was. She broke into a wide grin, her arms outstretched toward me, the grease from the fries already seeping through the box and onto her black isotoner gloves. "Shit," I said, loud enough for Kathleen O'Hara to hear. She'd tell on me for sure for swearing. "God damn it," I added, for good measure. If prayers didn't work, maybe curses would, maybe God would strike me dead. But no such luck. My mother was upon me, yanking my hand out of my pocket and thrusting the sad, soggy box into it. I wished I was Jake Riley. I imagined his prayers were heard. He had everything he wanted the second it entered into his head. He probably spoke to God in monosyllables and even got to skip the deer part the nuns insisted we always start every prayer with. Maybe my prayers needed to be more specific. Maybe I should have said, "Dear God, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, and all the holy saints, don't let my mother or father or anybody they know who owes them any favor or who works in their beauty shop or who came from Italy or who even knows somebody from Italy or has dark hair for that matter or who speaks in a funny accent come near me carrying any food for my lunch. I'm not that hungry, and anyway, Dickie Cooper owes me his chocolate pudding because I forged his father's name on the test he failed last week. Amen." "Christian," my mother trilled, her heavily accented voice nasal from perpetually inhaling various hair coloring products. "Did you think I forgot your lunch today? What kind of mama would do that? I came all this way to give it to you, but now I have to hurry back to the shop and get Mrs. Foster out from the dryer, or her hair will dry and fall out, and that's not good to have an unhappy customer." Behind me, I could sense Goliath snarling, strands of dangling drool beginning to form puddles at his feet. Like smelling salts, the chicken McNugget aroma had awakened the beast. At the very same moment every day, I wished I didn't have a mother. Who needed one? Or a father, for that matter. All they did was make me a laughingstock whenever they decided to show up. I wish they'd go back to Italy and let me fend for myself, or that they'd let me move in with my grandparents. At least when I could go to school in Blue Island instead of St. Damien with the spoiled rich kids who lived in boring Oak Forest. I couldn't understand why they wanted so badly to fit in with these people. We weren't like them. We didn't have money like they did. Besides, they worked such long hours every day, it wasn't like they even had the time to enjoy it if they wanted to. Thankfully, as soon as the bell rang at 3 o'clock, I could leave them all behind. The bratty kids and snobby parents, my own parents, the priests, the nuns, the prayers, the God who would send me to hell if I ate meat on Friday. Come 3 o'clock, I'd be out the door and in a car, headed to paradise. So this scene is actually the scene when I was 14 years old and I was recruited. Early one evening, Scully and I stood zoning out high on weed, staring at a squawking ebony crow perched atop one of the twisted light posts that lined the alley behind his house. We passed a joint back and forth, giggling like little girls. The garages on either side of the narrow dead-end alley were crammed with a myriad of old furniture, stacked boxes of orphan mason jar lids, piles of plastic nativity sets, and unraveling lawn chairs. With no space left inside for even half a Yugo to squeeze in, we weren't worried about anybody pulling up on us. As far as we were concerned, these deserted back streets existed solely as a gathering place for us kids. "Hey, Scully," I said, face pointed to the sky as I studied the winged intruder looking down on us from atop the flickering streetlight. "Do you think that old crow knows what we're doing?" He laughed. "I don't know, man, but that's a seriously dumb question." As Scully craned his neck to look up at the watchful bird, the shotgun roar of a car bursting up the alley broke the calm. "Shit." He tossed the joint. I retrieved it. "Chill out, man. It's only carmine." But as it turned out, I was wrong. Carmine's primer black 1969 Pontiac Firebird screeched to a skidding halt in the gravel beside us. I gawked at the stark contrast of the white death's head skull, freshly spray-painted on the corner of the matte hood. Damn, could anybody be cooler than Carmine? With the intermittent amber glow of the street lamp lighting the car from above, the passenger door snapped open, and this older dude with a shaved head and black combat boots headed straight toward us. He wasn't unnaturally tall or imposing physically, but his closely cropped hair and shiny boots smacked of authority. Over a crisp white t-shirt, thin scarlet suspenders held up his bleach-spotted jeans. He stepped across the beam of headlights and swiftly closed the distance between us. You'd have thought he turned in that alley specifically to hunt us down. I pulled back, wondering what the hell we'd done to piss this guy off. Inches from me, he stopped and leaned in close, his beady, ashen eyes holding mine. The white surrounding his granite pupils looked old, time-worn, intense. Barely opening his mouth, he spoke softly, with a listen-closely-now attitude. "Don't you know that's exactly what the capitalists and Jews want you to do, so they can keep you docile?" Not knowing exactly what the hell a capitalist was or what docile meant, my nervous instinct was to take a swift draw from the joint and involuntarily cough smoke straight into his face. With stunning ninja-like speed, this guy with the penetrating gray eyes smacked the back of my head with one hand and simultaneously snatched a joint from my lips with the other, crushing it with his shiny black boot. I was speechless, frozen. I turned to Scully, but he'd vanished. Blood retreated like flowing ice water through my veins and pooled in my heavy tingling extremities. Shaking my head to regain my composure, I mustered enough confidence and tried to save face in front of Carmine. What do you know? And who the hell are you anyway? You're not my father, I sputtered. My voice sounded weak in my own ears. The stubbly, sharp-jawed man straightened up and gripped my shoulder firmly, drawing me in towards him. "What's your name, son?" His voice was steady and earnest. I stammered nervously into lukewarm broken pieces. Chris. Picciolini. "That's a fine Italian name," he said, his voice suddenly sounding kind. I braced myself for the inevitable knockout punchline. Everybody used to always make fun of my last name, that's why. And he leaned in and said, "Your ancestors were quite exquisite warriors, leaders of men. You should be proud of your name." From my experience living in Oak Forest, I wasn't, though. "Did you know the Roman army, the centurion commanders specifically, are considered among the greatest white European warriors in the history of mankind?" I didn't. He took out a folded piece of paper and a pen from his jeans pocket and scribbled the word centurion on it. "And Roman women are divine goddesses," he added with a sly smile. That much I knew. I cracked a slight grin as he thrust the paper into my hand. "Go to the library and look it up. Then come find me and tell me what you've learned about yourself and your glorious people." In the background, Carmine was leaning against his rumbling Firebird, glossed boots with white straight laces covering his crossed ankles. He looked different, focused. Pinching his cigarette and exhaling a thick, steely plume of smoke, he could have been James Dean. "The kid's cool, Clark. They're waiting for us. We should go." "Well, Christian Picciolini," he said, grasping my clammy hand, "I'm Clark Martel, and I'm going to save your fucking life." With that, he nodded to Carmine, who jumped into his car and pulled it up alongside us. As quickly as he'd arrived, this guy climbed back inside the roaring beast, and he and Carmine tore off down the alley like a burning phoenix, leaving me surrounded by a cloud of exhaust and confusion. Okay, so now we're fast-forwarding 8 years. I got in, I was recruited when I was 14, and I managed to get out and disengage when I was 22. By that time, at 19, I'd gotten married, and my wife and I had two sons by the time we were 21. Those little boys are going to be 26 and 24 this year. I can't believe that. By now, this is at the very end. my wife had left me and taken the kids. She wasn't part of what I was a part of, and she always hated it. And I just, I never made the brave choice to choose my family because the movement was really all I had known my whole life. So this is kind of giving you my mindset when I was leaving. Between my friend's hate-related murder, my disillusionment with the movement I'd helped build, and the fact that due to my experiences at the record store, I couldn't reconcile hating the people I'd once wanted to eliminate on principle alone, I began to let go of my biases. I discovered so many commonalities that I could not in good conscience disparage anyone based on superficial differences. I simply couldn't justify or rationalize my prejudices any longer. Memories of the past 7 years flashed through my mind, and they made me angry. I thought about the Ku Klux Klan with their ridiculous dunce caps and tablecloth clown costumes, the racist sovereign constitutionalists who carried automatic weapons to the grocery store and felt like man-made laws didn't apply to them, the Christian identity nuts that distorted the Bible to suit their perverse dogmatism that turned God into a vengeful Aryan warlord who sought to slay the mud races, which they say are reincarnations of the devil, the revisionist historians who claimed the Holocaust never happened and 6 million Jews somehow magically evaporated from the earth, the laughable American Nazi Party stormtroopers dressed as if every day were Halloween with their brown Boy Scout shirts and fancy culottes, the racial odinists who believed that fairy Viking gods who lived in the clouds would strike down the dark-skinned infidels with bolts of lightning and a crack of Thor's hammer, and the neo-Nazi skinhead gangbangers who fooled themselves into believing that they had an ounce of courage running through their veins, or that they were better than anybody else, when they weren't. And in reality, they were filled with a volatile cocktail of cheap beer and self-loathing to fuel their hate. Now, when I looked into the mirror, I saw a hollow shell of a man, a stranger, filled with all of those same toxic elements staring back at me. For one third of my life, I chewed and swallowed gristly bits of each one of those twisted ideologies, and now all I felt like doing was jamming my fingers down my throat and vomiting them all up into the nearest toilet. I felt sick, like a dope fiend detoxing from selfish power and control instead of heroin, always needing more and blindly living my life on a razor's edge to score the next hateful fix. The horrible actions of my last 7 years had begun with my extreme loneliness as a child and materialized themselves as vengeful hate and bigotry. I'd blamed everyone but myself for what I believed had been taken away from me as a young boy. I was angry with my parents for abandoning me for their careers, and I took misplaced aggression out on the world, blaming those who I failed to make an effort to understand, rather than taking responsibility for my own feelings and actions. And because I was so blind, too overly ambitious to pay attention to my true emotions, I ended up blaming others, blacks, gays, Jews, and anyone else who I thought wasn't like me, for my problems in my own life they couldn't possibly have contributed to. My unfounded panic quickly and unjustly manifested itself as venomous hatred, and I became radicalized by those who saw in me a lonely youngster who was ripe to be molded. And because I was so desperately searching for meaning, to rise above the mundane, I devoured any crumbs I was fed that resembled greatness, made them my identity, overshadowing my own authentic character, the same one that I'd grown weary of as a kid. And through my misguided animosity, I'd become a big, fat, racist bully. Morbidly obese from the countless lies I'd been fed by those who took advantage of my youth, naivete, and loneliness, toxins I'd eagerly feasted on. Now I just wanted the poison inside of me to get out.
That was it. Thank you. Fred Gardefee is Distinguished Professor of English and Italian-American Studies at Queens College, CUNY, and the John D. Calandra Italian-American Institute. Past director of Stony Brook University's American and Italian-American Studies programs, he is a Fulbright Fellow and past president of the Italian-American Studies Association, MELIS, and the Working Class Studies Association. His books include Italian Signs, American Streets, The Evolution of Italian-American Narrative, Day Goes Red, Tradition and the Italian-American Writer, Mustache Pete is Dead, Leaving Little Italy, From Wise Guys to Wise Men, Masculinities and the Italian-American Gangster, The Art of Reading Italian Americana, and Read 'em and Reap. He is co-founder and co-editor of VIA, Voices in Italian Americana, editor of the Italian-American Culture Series of SUNY Press, and a frequent contributor to Fra Noi, L'Italo Americano, and I Italy magazine and television. Please welcome Fred Gardefee.
I wasn't born a racist, but I became one. And one of the hardest things to come to terms with once you've made this realization is understanding how the same people who taught you love could teach you how to hate. I had a similar upbringing to the man who wrote this book. I grew up in a little Italy across the railroad tracks from a black suburb of Chicago. And many were the violent encounters between blacks and Italians during those days. It would take me years to understand that our fear of blacks had nothing to do with them or how they might hurt us, but with how we in Melrose Park feared we would become like them. They were the dark thoughts of our minds that we avoided by projecting those thoughts onto them. One day, after hearing the news report about a civil rights march that happened in the city, my grandfather told me, "If they ever try to march around here, I'll go up on the roof and pick them off one by one as they come across the tracks." I didn't dare ask him why he felt that way, but the tone in his voice told me he was serious. Thank God he died before Fred Hampton was murdered. I began to hope that blacks would never try to march near our place, but the fear that blacks would come into our lives was only one that we shared. The other had to do with those white people, like the Irish. While I had some experiences like those Christopher writes of, Our lives' paths took very different directions. I searched inward for answers while he looked outside himself. Through my studies, I came to understand that Italians weren't always white, and that in order for us to become white, we would have to become racists. Christian Picciolini wasn't born a racist, but he became one. At the root of his racism was a fear of the unknown. And Picciolini tells us that it doesn't take much for that fear of the other to turn into an anger that can fuel terrible acts. The key to understanding why and how an Italian-American kid learned to hate that which he didn't know lies in the way he wasn't taught to deal with the frustrations that face every child as he or she grows from adolescence into adulthood. It doesn't take much for a victim of racism to turn into a racist himself. Picciolini was born to Italian immigrants whose difficulties in making the transition from immigrant to American kept them from understanding the very world into which they were sending their son as they concentrated on the work they needed to survive and thrive in working class America. While they were busy building their beauty salon business, Christian was forging his identity through his negative encounters with classmate taunts about his difference and constant threats from the like of a guy named Goliath, the class bully that Christian knocks down with one lucky punch, changing the way his peers perceive him and teaching him that violence is the way to protect and defend yourself in a world that fears difference. As he moves from his grandparents' care in a blue-collar neighborhood of Blue Island, Illinois, to his parents' American dream home in middle-class Oak Forest, Christian gains notoriety with power through his fists. While success in the classroom comes easily, it's not enough. And to channel that mix of curiosity and fear of life that comes to every teenager. So he looks elsewhere for a way to make sense of his own life. By the age of 14, he's under the influence of Chicago's first skinheads, who give him a sense of belonging that is protected by fighting not only the establishment, but also those whom the establishment suppresses. Surrounded by these formidable forces, Picciolini gathers like haters to build a revolution that connects disenchanted white kids like him to the larger white supremacy movement that is growing in the 1980s and 90s. While he seems bent on changing the world, his actions don't come without doubts. Quote, "From time to time, I may have felt guilty for my actions and pondered whether all the white supremacist stuff I was feeding these kids was right. It didn't always go down so easily for me. The anxiety from the constant violence that existed 24 hours a day, the hateful ideology I programmed with myself with to override the old world values I'd been raised on. Had those old world values been reinforced through his education, had there been opportunities for this young boy to understand the history of his own ancestors, he might have seen the arbitrary difference skin color creates and the false sense of entitlement that comes with empowering whiteness." Picciolini writes powerfully of the damage he caused and the pains he felt before he could reject his past and embrace a different future. This is not some wistful apology for a misguided life or "I found the light" confession. White American youth is the story of what goes on inside every kid who gets lost in a world of fear and finds his humanity by connecting to the very ones he once feared. This story confronts the reality of American racism that continues to wreak havoc in our world today. Picciolini shows us a way out. Thank you.
I think this is the only time in my life I will have an opportunity to talk, to be so close to someone on the other side. And there is a question that has been nagging me for the longest time and that no one could have ever answered. Not that you necessarily will be able to, but at least
do my best.
You are there. Why is it that, and this is actually a question that shows up in Black Klansmen momentarily, for the first time I saw it. Why is it that white supremacists and Nazis deny the Holocaust instead of being proud of it? What is the rationale? I mean,
that's a good question.
Okay, that's all I need to say.
Yeah, no, that's a really, really good question because you would think that that would be something that they would brag about, right? Their enemies, they killed them. And I can tell you why, because the public face that they're trying to put out is not one of hatred. They're trying to, and we always have you know, even 30 years ago when I was involved, to the public, we always wanted to tone down what it is we were talking about so that we could manipulate them and recruit them. So when you hear, you know, chants of White Lives Matter, not only are they co-opting from a real civil rights organization, but they're trying, they're using that instead of white power, which they know is going to turn people away. But if they say white pride, that's hard to argue against. You know, I mean, they'll make a case for that. But what they do is they put this, you know, the public face on that's, you know, much more palatable, much easier to swallow for people. I mean, they're even wearing khakis and polo shirts now as opposed to what we looked like 30 years ago. And that was because of a strategy to blend in 30 years ago. So the answer to that question is behind closed doors, they're high-fiving each other over the Holocaust. But in public, they'll say, oh, it didn't happen. It's just, you know, we're, because it's always about them being victimized. It's never about them victimizing anybody. So by denying the Holocaust, they're saying, you see, you know, the Jews are lying to us. We're the victims, blah, blah, blah. So that's why. You're welcome.
Hi, I grew up a couple towns over in Dalton. I have a couple of questions, but I'll ask one right now, which is, sure. Could you talk a little bit more, since you jumped over it, mm-hmm. the actual structures of the white power groups that you were involved in, and how they built organization on the south side, or maybe the west side of Chicago, in sort of concrete terms?
30 years ago, roughly around 1997... 96, 97, which is right when I left, was going into 96, there was this strategy to mainstream the ideology. The idea was, you know, don't shave your head, don't get tattoos, don't wave swastika flags, blend in, become doctors, go to college, recruit on campus, become law enforcement, get jobs in the prison industry, run for politics. And the whole idea was to shed... You know, to blend into the into conservative America is what I'm trying to say, into all of America, really. So there is no structure because the strategy was called leaderless resistance, which means that once people are indoctrinated into the ideology, they're told to disengage, and they have a mission. You know, the mission is to, you know, hurt the enemy, hurt the system, things like that. They are then put out on their own, and that's where this whole lone wolf strategy comes from. Because the idea was, if you blend in and you're not part of a group, it's impossible to take down the hierarchy of the group if there is no group, so you can't be infiltrated. It's harder for the enemies to see you coming. Here we are 23 years later. I never thought it would work, but they figured it out. So there is no, I mean, there is. There's still some remnant of what I used to be. That's important. They wanted to keep some visible, you know, to strike terror or whatever. There is no, you know, there are some spokespeople, figureheads, but there is no membership. There is no, I mean, the internet made it possible because on the internet, you know, first of all, their reach is further, propaganda is spread further. You know, when I was recruited, I got a pamphlet and an invite to a meeting. It's not like that anymore. It's more dangerous.
Thank you. I have two very quick questions.
Sure.
I saw the special that you did on MSNBC, and I was really struck by it, which is why I came tonight. I think what you're doing is really important. One thing I was wondering when I was watching it is, maybe you could talk a little bit about what that moment of was for you, where you realize that your whole world had been a lie or had been based on something that you were responding to psychologically. I don't think that really came through.
Yeah.
And I'm just curious about that. My second one is kind of a related question. In this political moment, I think what you're doing is really important. But I wonder what the intervention of your politics is. Like, not whether you're a Democrat or Republican, because we know this is systemic, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
What kind of political intervention would matter in this moment?
As far as the first one, there was not one moment. It was hundreds of them. I had doubts every day. And every day I would stuff down those doubts because I was getting, you know, a sense of identity, a sense of community, and a sense of purpose. Those are three things that I was searching for, that we all search for, that I wasn't able to find anywhere. And this man in the alley at 14 years old was the first person to really pay attention to me. And I didn't understand a word of what he was saying. I didn't, you know, I mean, I grew up kind of the, you know, what you were just, not to that extent, you know, before 14, but I mean, my parents were the victims of prejudice. They didn't really talk about that. You know, they were part of a, you know, a racist white system, but I didn't learn how to hate people at home. It was actually the opposite. So it was, you know, the things that they kind of set the foundation for. And as throughout the 8 years that I was involved, there would be moments where I would just meet people and I'd kind of, you know, groove with them and I'd be like, oh, I can't like them. And I, you know, you'd walk away because, you know, the draw of those three things, identity, community, and purpose, was stronger. And the further you get in, the more it becomes who you are. And you know, you have to keep expressing it. I mean, this is not a friendly, you know, group. So you have to keep working to stay a part of it. I think ultimately there were three major points. My children being born challenged my whole sense of identity, community, and purpose from the movement to the family. And that's when I really started thinking about it. Unfortunately, I didn't make the right decision. The second one was I opened a record store to sell racist music that I was importing. And during that process, I, you know, to get a business license, I couldn't say, hey, I'm a racist record store, give me a license. I started to sell other music like punk rock and hip hop and heavy metal. And the people that I met, my customers who knew everything about me, it was, you know, Chicago is a small, or is a big, small city, or small, big city, I guess. Everybody knew what I was about. And they still came in and shopped, and they could have broken my windows. They could have punched me. They could have argued with me. They didn't, you know, and it was the first chance for me to have a meaningful interaction with African-Americans, with gay people, with Jewish people. And at first I was super standoffish. I didn't want to get to know them, but they kept coming back. And it was the compassion that I received from them when I least deserved it. And they were people that I least deserved it from, because I, you know, it hurt anybody like them. That really was a big transformation for me. And then the final thing that, you know, this was after I'd left, but I still hadn't talked about my past. I tried to outrun it for 5 years. I thought, I'll move, I'll wear long sleeves to cover my tattoos. You know, I was already, you know, treating people well. I was not treating myself very well. And this is a long story, but I'll tell it as short as I can. After that 5 years, I'd been waking up depressed. I didn't want to wake up when I would wake up. And then a friend came to me and she said, you know, you have to change your life, because I don't want to see you die. And I said, all right, what do you got? And she had just started working at IBM, and she's like, well, go apply for a job at IBM. And I said, are you crazy? I'm an ex-Nazi. I'm covered in tattoos. I went to 6 high schools. I got kicked out of all of them, one of them twice. I didn't go to college. I didn't own a computer. Why would they even let me in the door to get an interview? But I went in, and after 3 interviews, I ended up getting a job. And it was just an entry-level job. And my first assignment was my old high school, the same one I got kicked out of twice, to install their computers. IBM didn't know. This just happened. And, of course, I was terrified, because it was, you know, 8 years after I'd gone to high school there, but everybody knew. I mean, they were still, like, you know, talking about me there. It was not a good situation. And, of course, you know, I'm hiding, you know, walking around dark hallways, and Mr. Holmes, the African-American security guard that I'd gotten in a fight with, that got me kicked out for the second time, let out in handcuffs, walks right in front of me. He didn't see me, but I saw him, and I didn't know what to do. I was scared, and I followed him to the parking lot as he was getting into his car, and I tapped him on the shoulder, and when he turned around and recognized me, he jumped back because he was afraid, and I didn't know what to say to this man. This is a guy who I'd hurt, you know, verbally, physically. I'd caused problems in his school. And all I could, you know, muster the courage or anything to say was, I'm sorry. And we talked, and, you know, he shook my hand, and we hugged, and we cried, and he was the first person that said, you have to go tell people what you went through. And this was, you know, 1999. None of the stuff that we're hearing about was happening because they'd gone underground. So people were, you know, like, yay, racists are gone. No. You just ask the person of color if they're gone. No. And he said, you know, because your story is not just some kid who was, you know, raised to hate and became a Nazi. He said, you are every kid that I've ever encountered in this school. And every kid in this school could go, you know, down some path like you did. It may not go be the same path, but they could, you know, get into a gang. They could get into drugs. They could commit suicide. You know, everybody's got these potholes in their lives that detour them on their journey. And he recognized that. And I'm grateful because he was the first person to encourage me to tell my story, you know, 18 years ago or whatever. And now we go fishing together. So thank you, Mr. Holmes.
Could you explain the flag on your hat?
It's a Chicago flag. But oh, it's it. I don't know that it has any special meaning, but it's just like a military color, and it's kind of like my ode to Chicago for the you know, the violence that's happening there.
Right.
Yeah, I don't wear anything but black. In case you haven't noticed, so I had to. It is my tribute. You know, people ask me all the time, like, you know, the racists ask, why don't you fix the problems in Chicago? I'm like, okay, well, then we need to fix the whole system. We need to, you know, overhaul every institution, because what I deal with is interpersonal racism. I work with haters. As far as the system goes, it's going to take all of us to fix that.
Thanks. That was really fabulous to hear. I have about 50 questions. So, I guess maybe a lot of them are in the book, answered in the book. But
mostly.
It sounds like... you've done a lot of inner work. Maybe
I've tried.
Maybe
still working.
Maybe therapy. I don't know. Maybe I'm assuming that, but it just strikes me as how thoughtful you are about this stuff, and I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
So I wanted to say that. I guess the question is, the image of Italian Americans in popular culture, you know, the mobster and all that stuff. I'm wondering how that has kind of got you into that place where, like, this is a group of men, these skinheads, and these other guys like that.
I think I always wanted to be a hero or an anti-hero. I wanted to just be a part of something that I think I was very idealistic. I mean, I could have, you know, been like the youth model UN. I probably would have been amazing at that had that got to me first. You know, there weren't a whole lot of gangster movies growing up as a kid. There was The Godfather, Godfather 2, Godfather 3, and then they stopped making good Godfathers. But actually, I like Godfather 4. I don't know why I said that. I don't think that was as much of an influence for me. I think I just, I wanted to be respected because I thought I had skills. I thought I was good at stuff, but that nobody saw that. Nobody ever gave me a chance. And when I stopped caring if people saw that in me, that's when I started to just act out so they would just see that about me. But what you said about projection, I really, looking back now, I know that I hated other people, not because of who they were, but because I hated myself. And I was projecting my pain onto them so that I could feel better about me. You know, for some people, unfortunately, who've never had happiness, making other people feel worse than them is the only way that they can feel good about themselves. I'm not making excuses for them. I'm not saying it's the right thing. I'm just trying to explain, you know, I've worked with hundreds of people, and every single one of them will tell me, like, you know, unless they were raised that way, which is actually a very small percentage, they'll say, I wasn't, you know, my parents were, you know, hippies. There was, you know, they had, you know, black friends all the time over to the house. They had nothing to do with it. Well, not ideologically, but maybe it was something that, you know, for me it was abandonment. They didn't teach me to hate, but they taught me to hate myself. So, yeah.
Your sons, what kinds of interaction are you having with them now?
Oh, we're very close. I never lost touch with my sons. Frankly, you know, to answer your question again, after I left, they really kept me alive because I wanted to be a good father. I never stopped wanting to be a good father. It just took me a little while to figure out how to be a good father. They're 26 and 24. My oldest son, Devin, I married an Irish girl. How many Italians, guys, marry an Irish girl? It's just a thing. But my older son, Devin, lives in San Francisco. He just started working for Facebook a month ago. He's really excited about that. And my son, Brandon, lives in Denver. He moved out there a year ago. He's a carpenter, just like my nonno was. And they're great. I mean, they were the first people. So I wrote this 10 years ago. I started writing it 10 years, or maybe 13 years ago now. They were the first ones when they were, I think, 11 and 13 to read my draft. They were always readers, but I wanted them to know, and I had talked to them about it, but I wanted them to know. I didn't write this to make me look good. I wrote it to be honest about, you know, and I wrote this before all this stuff was happening in the world because I knew it wasn't going anywhere. It was just hiding. They're good.
I understand why you were compelled to write this book, but could you talk a little bit about how you learned to write? Like how did, I mean, you, this is a wonderfully written book and your reading of it just is a testament to it. I mean, you talked about these early drafts. Could you talk about that process? Like how you learned to become a writer?
Thank you. I don't know. I mean, a lot of reading, I think. And 10 years it took it, you know, I'm not cranking out books like this guy over here. Well, yeah, try spending 10 writing one. I loved to, I always loved to read. You know, spending a lifetime up to 14 alone, you find a way to entertain yourself. One of those ways was reading. And thank you, I really appreciate that. I wrote what was in my heart and in my head, and you know, there are some sentences that are 30 words long and some that are one word long. I've been told it sounds pretty nice when it all comes together. So thank you. I appreciate that.
Hi, I think like everybody in the room, I've got about 50,000 questions for you. So I'll read the book and then I'll write to you.
Thank you.
But tonight, two things keep racing around in my mind, and it's sort of discrimination and segregation. And I know you're dealing with individuals and one-on-one and a lot of stuff around feelings, but those feelings get translated into ideologies and policies and practices. And I'm thinking about my own growing up, and I think that one of the things that helped me break out of what could have been a comfortable bias as an Italian-American young girl, hearing at the dinner table, oh, those dirty N-words and this and that, almost regularly, was that I went to a school that was mixed race. It was a Catholic school, and it was in the inner city, in a small city, Wilmington, Delaware. And in that school, the stuff I was hearing at home from some of my family members, not all, was challenged by my personal interactions. The other thing is that the discrimination piece, right? So there's the segregation of the school system, and so I wanted to ask you about your school. And then secondarily, the sense that Italian Americans felt like victims and felt like victims of discrimination as new immigrants. In your parents' instance, they were immediate immigrants. In my parents, it had been two generations, but there was still this level of, we don't get what they get. Those people are getting more than we got. So, double-headed thing. What about those two systems, segregation and discrimination, in your own story?
So as far as segregate, if I'm understanding the question correctly, I mean, I grew up in a very exclusive Italian-American bubble. I mean, my neighborhood was people that for generations had lived on the same mountain in, you know, near Potenza. So they all knew each other, and they only felt comfortable. They were not Italian-Americans. They were Italians. They didn't want, I mean, they loved America, but they didn't want to be Americans. They held on to their traditions. And I think part of that was fear. Part of that was not, you know, being fully accepted. So they had to learn how to make do. So growing up, my segregation was, I was in an Italian bubble. It wasn't about people of color. It was about Americans. I mean, Americans were just bad, you know? So that was my first kind of shock, my first kind of upbringing to like discrimination, I guess. Even though I didn't, you know, see it as like a, you know, a race thing. It was just like, oh, if you're not Italian, you're not cool. Which now looking back was very racist. As far as, what was the other question? Oh, about my schooling. So the Catholic school that I was reading about, I was the outsider. Everybody there was white as the driven snow. And being the Italian kid with olive skin, whose parents, you know, didn't speak great English, who, you know, had really weird customs, and I think I may have been the first kid on earth to ever bring a Nutella sandwich to school with charcuterie, you know, like before it was cool to do that. And, I couldn't have been a bigger alien, you know, from a different planet to these kids. Contrasted to my time in the Italian neighborhood, where I was then seen as an outsider by the Italian kids because we moved to a white suburb. Growing up, my schools were white. They were 100% white. I was, you know, the minority kid in the school. But high school was about a third, you know, African American, about a third Latino, and about a third white. And that was a big culture shock to me all of a sudden. And I didn't know where I belonged, you know. I'm glad you're talking about this because I think it's really important that, and you didn't, you know, acknowledge, you know, white racism, but I want to make sure that when we speak as white people, there are things that we say that are wrong and we don't know they're wrong. And I'm not, again, making excuses for us, but I'm glad we're having these conversations so that we're, you know, talking about, you know, these things that maybe we've never talked about before and we're learning. We're not going to get it right. We're all racist white people, and we're going to learn how to get it right. But we have to put ourselves out there to do that. So I just want to say that.
I'm curious, which type of people besides like white men do these hate group target? Do they target women as well? Mm-hmm. And continuing off of that, which are they targeting particular classes? So in your case, it was from like a working class to middle class background. Is middle class more vulnerable to joining these groups, or is a working class white person more vulnerable to joining these groups?
So back in 1987, before the internet came around, you know, finding recruits meant going to skate parks, meant going to, you know, video arcades, punk rock concerts, and looking for the kids that didn't look like they had very much of anything else. Because it was about, you know, promising them paradise, drawing them in, saying, we love you, you're our fan. It's a cult. It's just like that. So at that point, we were targeting more, I think, like middle class, lower middle class. But that's not to say, you know, there weren't people with degrees who had a lot of money. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't exclusive to just, you know, low income people who were in poverty. And it's not like that now. Racism is, you know, I hate to say it, but it doesn't discriminate. Does that make sense? It does discriminate, but it doesn't. They will take anybody. Today, they are, it's more heavily women today than it used to be. And that's because because of the internet, they've learned to attract young women so that the women can be the propaganda mouthpieces, like on their, you know, Holocaust denial videos or, you know, alt-right stuff, things like that, because they know it draws in young guys. I can't tell you how many Jewish mothers I get emails from who are horrified that their son came home with a swastika tattoo. You know, I've worked with neo-Nazis in the Philippines. I've worked with you know, people born of Latino parents who were born in Mexico, who are, you know, alt-right whatevers. It is not, like what I said earlier, this is not about ideology. It is about building a social movement that they want to weaponize. And there's very specific people who are pulling the strings for this stuff. And you know, they're doing really disturbing things. They're going to, and the internet again, they're going to like autism forums online and recruiting people there because they, you know, they're banking on the fact that there are marginalized people in there who in real life may not have developed friendships, or they're going to online gaming forums. You know, when our kids are playing with the headsets and talking to people, ask your kid if he's ever been attempted to be recruited by a white supremacist. 9 times out of 10, they'll say yes. That is how it's happening. Most of it is coming from Eastern Europe and from Russia. We hear all this stuff about like Russian fake news and it is true. Let me tell you, we started pushing Russian propaganda in the 80s. I mean, even before that, the whole idea that, you know, Jews want to control the world through the media and through banking systems, that was based on a forged booklet called the Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion that was put out by Russia in 1909 because they hated, because they were anti-Semitic after the Russian Empire fell. They needed somebody to blame, and that penetrated the mainstream and still today is the most influential piece of propaganda that influences Nazis. They're still doing it. They are the masters of active measures of disrupting, you know, westernized, liberal, democratic societies. And the internet has given them mega weapons.
I'm just curious a little bit about, you know, the impact that your book has had on the movement that you were a part of. And I'm also thinking about legal repercussions. So I was wondering, first of all, like, have you been receiving death threats from people that you have exposed? And also, has your book played any role from a legal point of view in getting these people in trouble? And, you know, the other thing that I'm really, you know, I'm hoping as I read the book that maybe I can find some of this, but I'm also wondering about your feelings towards the people that you have been with for 8 years. And as much as you might, I mean, and this is very similar to people who belong to the Drangta, you know, mafia, where you are in this really strange situation where you know that these people are doing something awful wrong, but you know, you might develop a real friendship or affection. And so I'm just wondering, like, how, you know, how do you sort all of this out? And again, from a legal point of view, what's the impact that your book has had?
The goal of my book was not to, it's not a tell-all book about anybody else but me. And I, you know, having written it, you know, 20 years after I left, I wanted to make sure that I wasn't implicating anybody who had turned around their life and was doing something good. Now, I do believe in holding people accountable. People always need to be held accountable. I held myself accountable for 23 years. I still do. I'm still making amends for the things that I did, and I always will. But again, the intention of the book was to give people an insight into why it happens, what happens when you're there, and how to get out, or how I got out. So it was never, I changed everybody's name but me and my family's in this book. I didn't want to, you know, it was important for me to be honest about that. But I mean, even like people that I mentioned once, I changed their name. It wasn't important. What was important was the actions and why and things like that. I have a terrible memory. I already forgot your other two questions. Oh, death threats. I'm sure if I check my phone right now, there will be death threats. I get probably, you know, anywhere between 2 and 20 a day. Not death threats, but threats in general. I get death threats too, but what are you going to do? I could get hit by a, you know, cab driver walking outside. That is unfortunately true, and also, you know, what they're calling the biggest domestic terrorist issue we have, Antifa, which is what? You know, I'm not here to badmouth any, you know, law enforcement. I respect what they do mostly. You know, there are good people there who want to do the right thing, and there are bad people there who are doing the bad things. However, most people don't know this, but since 9/11, and you know, today is 9/11, hard to forget. Since 9/11, more Americans have been killed on U.S. soil by white supremacists. Not just open, avowed white supremacists than any other terrorist group, foreign or domestic, combined by a factor of two. We don't even call it terrorism. The problem is they are not focused on the real issues. I mean, I'm sure they are. I don't want to speak for them. I'm sure that there are FBI, you know, units that are focused on white supremacists. But until we start equating them with the terrorism that we see that everybody hates, there are going to be some people who are going to be okay being white supremacists. But we have to stigmatize it. We have to say, this is not the right thing to do. And I'm not going to say this is not America, because unfortunately that is America. It has been America since our ancestors 500 years ago brought the slave trade over here. And it's not stopped, despite us not calling it slavery. That's all I'll say on that. Thank you.